Of that. This is prepared by Dr. Shreyas Payag and Dr. John Paul. And I've got many slides from the conference from ISSM in Jaipur. Okay, it's a critical care conference. So basically, graphics, it's an essential tool, and a skilled practitioner has to know about this graphics so that he can troubleshoot whatever is happening to the patient. That is the basic idea of understanding graphics. Okay. There are two types basically. First is scalar, which is plotted against time. So it is a single variable which is plotted against time. So as you can see, the x-axis is time always. Okay, in scalars, x-axis is
Dr.
time.
Dr. Fasil.
Yeah.
Fasil.
Can you make it?
You have to change to the first slide. Go to the first slide.
Slide show.
I think the slide is of IMV and the slide is not moving. Yeah. Good, good. Okay. Fine.
Wait, go ahead. Give me a second. Can you see the slides now?
One second. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Make it PowerPoint.
Yeah. Now it's full screen, right?
It's not full screen. Not
make
full
it screen. Slideshow.
So there is usually like 30 seconds lag. Just hold on. It will happen.
Can you see a PowerPoint with a graph?
No, we are seeing the essentials of ventilator waveforms and your name.
Okay, I've changed it. Maybe it might come. 30-second lag is there.
Sir, I would suggest just escape the full PowerPoint mode and take it in the normal presentation mode.
Yeah.
Now it is visible.
Is it okay now?
Yes. If you can just
slide is fourth one.
Yeah. On the scale of if you can see on the bottom right, there is a scale of 0 to 70. Right now, you can shift it a little more to the right side. Yeah, and now you can make it full screen. So even if you escape, it will be the same side.
Okay, can you see it now?
We are seeing the slide of Skylar.
Yeah, okay. So let me just... Okay, can you see the next loop? Pressure volume loop?
So I would suggest if you can stop sharing and reshare. It will come to the full screen mode then.
Okay.
Now okay, sir.
Now okay.
Okay.
Now perfect.
Yeah. So basically scalars, you have everything is either flow, pressure or volume is plotted against time. Okay, I'm just going a bit slow here because I know this might be a repetition and most of you might be knowing it, but I think I should cover this first before going to the next level. So I'm just mentioning it. That is everything is plotted in under x-axis. Okay. And so the time progresses in x-axis, and whether it is flow, pressure or volume, it is plotted against the time. That is scalars. Now, when you come to loops, there's something called as loops. When you come to loops, there is no time in it. Okay, it is either pressure volume loop or flow volume loop. Now, as we know, pressure becomes positive and then it becomes negative, or volume becomes there will be inflation and deflation. So that is why it's called as loops, because it starts from one point. During inspiration, the volume increases, pressure increases. During expiration, the volume and pressure both decreases and comes to the same point back. Okay, that is why this is called as loops. Okay, because it is not plotted against time, and pressure volume, it is a loop because both of it starts at a point and ends at the same point. Okay, after expiration. Now coming to a normal breath, first we should know the physiology of normal breath before going into a mechanically ventilated breath. So both are actually different. In a ventilated breath, it is positive pressure. As we all know, it's positive pressure. Normal breath, when you take, intrathoracic pressure is negative. So as you can see in this scalar, this is a pressure time scalar. You can see the pressure will be negative during inspiration and it will be positive during expiration. Okay, so as we all know that when you take a breath inside, it is air goes inside because the intrathoracic pressure becomes negative. That is how you take in air, and you due to the elastic recoil of the chest wall, it compresses and the and expiration starts. Okay, so that is what happens in normal breath, in spontaneous breath. Now just to compare all three in spontaneous breath, that is if you look at flow, pressure, volume. Yeah, when I mention all three, when I'm saying all three, these are the three most important scalars, and I think all the ventilators will have these three scalars, and probably they will not have more than these three scalars also. So always these are the three main things: flow, pressure and volume, and all of these are related. That is something what you have to know. So if you look at spontaneous breath, there will be a slow during inspiration, there will be an increase in flow. Just imagine taking a breath, there will be an increase in flow. By the end of your inspiration, your flow also will decrease. That is, flow is liter per minute. That means it is the speed of how much of air you take in. So during the start of inspiration, the speed will start it will start increasing because it starts from zero. And then it increases, then it will decrease. Once your lungs starts getting filled, it will decrease. And then the flow rate, flow will change direction. When this becomes from positive to negative, what it means is during inspiration, we were taking in, and at the end of expiration, that is here, at the end of expiration, the flow, you start to expire, that the flow reverses. So that is why this becomes negative, okay? And the same continues. That is, slowly the flow will increase, and as the air inside, that is your as the tidal volume inside your lung decreases, it will go back to the baseline, okay? Now look at the pressure. It is again a similar method. It's similar. That is, during inspiration it will be negative, and once the expiration starts, or during inspiration, once it starting, it will be negative. Once the air starts gets filling in, the pressure starts mounting up. And when you have an high pressure situation in the lung, you stop your inspiration and you just allow for elastic recoil. So during this recoil, the pressure neutralizes and becomes zero. Okay, this is how expiration takes place. Okay, now look at the volume. The volume starts increasing, reaches a maximum, and once the expiration starts, it starts decreasing and reaches zero. So this is what happens in normal respiration. I think you should know what happens in normal respiration so that it will be easier for everyone to understand mechanical respiratory waveforms. Okay, next, this is a mechanical positive pressure ventilation breath overlapped on a normal inspiration and expiration. Okay, that is, as you can see, first during inhalation, the initial part is always negative in normal breath. But in mechanical breath, it is positive for obvious reasons. Okay, why it becomes positive is because you are pushing in air to say in as easy as possible, you are pushing in air rather than making a cavity negative. During normal breaths, you make your intrathoracic cavity negative and the air is sucked in. Okay, but during positive pressure ventilation, you literally push in air. That is why it is called positive pressure. So when you start pushing, the pressure starts increasing immediately. Okay, on the other hand, when you start inspiring, it's the inspiration part. First you have to make it negative, then as the air fills inside the lung, the pressure starts increasing and reaches it will go above zero, and that is the time when it somewhere over here, that is the time when you start expiration. Okay, so I think this graph is clear. If anybody wants to intervene or interrupt, you can, because these are graphics. You might not remember the question later. If it is possible for me to explain in between, I will definitely do. Okay, so next is a mechanical breath. I'll explain in detail about each graph, each scalar. So first is a pressure time scalar. Probably this is pressure and flow is most important of the three. Pressure and flow is the most important. If you ask me to choose two scalars from this, definitely it would be pressure and flow. Okay, now pressure. This is again y-axis is pressure and x-axis is time. That is standard. Now, first thing you have to know is PEEP. What is PEEP? Post-end expiratory pressure. So that is the pressure which will be present after expiration. Okay. So that is the pressure which will be present before inspiration. Okay, so at this point, that is when inspiration is going to start, or when we are planning to give, when the ventilator is giving a positive pressure, there will be an amount of pressure already inside the cavity. Inside there will be an alveolar pressure that is called as post-end expiratory pressure, and that is why your baseline will never go below PEEP. Okay. So your baseline, if you have set a PEEP of 5, it is going to be, your baseline is always going to be around, it is always going to be 5. And that is where you start your inspiration. So when you start your inspiration, so this is the point when inspiration starts, positive pressure is given. So as you can see, positive pressure increases. And once you reach a time, so if it is a controlled breath, the TI is defined, that is you define in the ventilator how much TI has to be given. So this time is defined by you. If it is a pressure controlled breath, this pressure, that is how much pressure it should go, is defined by you. So basically with this equation, that is pressure and time, you will know how much volume a patient will take, provided the compliance is not changed. Okay. Now, once inspiration is over, the maximum pressure achieved is called as peak inspiratory pressure. Okay, PIP. Now, after that, expiration starts, as you can see, and the time from there is obviously called as expiratory time, and TE, represented as TE. So this is the first scalar. That's why I'm explaining all terms. Next, this is an inspiratory flow pattern. So as you can see, next I'm coming to flow time scalar. This might look complicated, but just concentrate on this, okay, this part. Now, what happens in a volume control? Volume control, you limit, it is flow limited. That is you limit your flow, okay? So that is you define flow in a volume control ventilation. So what happens? Suppose I have set flow as 70 liter per minute. What this means is, in volume control, what this means is, as soon as your inspiration starts, your flow rate, that is your speed of the air going in, should be 70 liter per minute. Okay, this is what is meant by flow. Okay, so you can see, just look at this scalar. The scalar goes like this. Okay, this is the scalar. Rest of it is drawn by me. Okay, anyway, so this is the start of inspiration. When the inspiratory valve or exhalation valve, whatever it is called, when it opens, when inspiration starts, okay, when inspiration starts after closing of exhalation valve, when it starts itself, 70 liter per minute of flow goes in. This is because it is a square pattern. Okay, so 70 liter per minute of air flows in for a defined time of TI. Okay, suppose 3 seconds, then that means 3 into 70. If it is 5 seconds, 5 into 70. So 350 ml of tidal volume goes in within a time of 5 seconds. So this is what you have set by saying that 70 liter per minute and a TI of 5 seconds. Now in most of the ventilator, in volume control, you set volume and flow. So TI basically is decided. So suppose if I set 350 tidal volume, and if I set a speed, that is if I set a flow of 70 liter per minute, that means because it's the tidal volume is 350 and the flow rate is 70, what this means is TI is 5 seconds. Okay, even though you are not setting TI, it is indirectly set by you. Even though directly you are not setting TI, it is indirectly set by you. Okay. So that is how flow happens. And once the expiratory valve opens, the flow immediately goes down to zero. Okay, so that is why, because flow is dependent on ventilator. You either start with 70 liter per minute or you make it zero. Okay, so this immediately goes down to zero. Now, what happens in expiration? I'll show you maybe a next slide. See, now in expiration, what happens is expiration again is not by the ventilator. That is something what you have to understand. It is by the elastic recoil of the chest wall, or in other words, it is also dependent on the compliance and resistance of your airway system. Okay, so expiration, even in a mechanically ventilated breath, is defined by compliance and your airway resistance. Okay, so this expiratory time is not set by you. This expiratory time is not set, is not defined in a ventilator. Okay, you define this. If TI is stable, if you increase the respiratory rate, obviously the expiratory time will decrease, because TI is set, or your flow and tidal volume is set. So it becomes a defined TI. You set a TI and you increase the respiratory rate, and that means this is going to definitely decrease your TE, that is expiratory time. Okay, so now what happens in expiration is, this is your peak expiratory flow rate, and this will slowly decrease, because like I've mentioned before, this is, yes, okay, sorry. So this is not by the ventilator. This limb, that is expiration, is not done by the ventilator. It is passive. It is passive exhalation by due to the elastic recoil and compliance and resistance of the airway. Okay, so it slowly starts decreasing. Once just imagine an inflated balloon. If you leave it by itself, what happens? Initially the flow will be high. Okay, so that is what happened. So this is inspiration. From inspiration, it comes to zero, and immediately it goes to the highest flow. So peak expiratory flow rate will be at the starting. Imagine the balloon losing its air. So as the air decreases, the pressure inside the balloon will decrease. Pressure inside the balloon will decrease, which will also decrease the flow rate. Okay, as the pressure inside the balloon decreases, the flow of air getting outside the balloon will decrease, and eventually it will come to zero when there is no air left. Okay, so this is what is happening in this flow time scalar. Okay, and this is the start of next breath. Okay, I hope this is clear, because it is based on this we'll be talking about other things. Now, coming to flow patterns, there are actually four patterns. It's called square, decelerating, accelerating, and sine pattern. Now, square is something what I've told you. That means if you set a square flow pattern right from the start of inspiration, and if you have set it at, suppose, 70 liter per minute, right from the start of inspiration, it starts at 70 liter per minute. Okay. If there is an accelerating flow, that means if you have set it at 70, it will slowly accelerate and reach 70. But in an accelerating flow, definitely the Ti required will be more for the same tidal volume, because assuming that the tidal volume is same in all these three, if in an comparing to a square pattern, in an accelerating flow, the tidal volume, if the tidal volume is same, the Ti required will be more, because initial part, it is not 70 liter per minute. In square wave pattern, it just starts at 70 liter per minute. In the initial part, in an accelerating flow, it starts maybe 30, 40, and then it slowly increases to 70. Obviously, it will take more time. Same thing happens in decelerating flow. Okay, usually you have a square and decelerating pattern in your ventilator waveforms. It doesn't make much of a difference, but if you need to increase the Ti or if you need to decrease the Ti, you can choose square wave, and if you need to increase the Ti, you can choose a decelerating pattern of flow. Okay, and a sine wave is something which is maybe seen in normal breaths. Okay. Now, components of inflation pressure. Now, I had shown you, we were talking about pressure. Now, I had shown you about flow. Now, there are some components of your total peak inspiratory pressure. Peak inspiratory pressure, as the name suggests, is the peak. That is, it is the total pressure. Now, there are two terms which you need to know. That is, one is plateau pressure, okay, and one is trans airway pressure. Okay, now what you have to understand is, as you can see, the pressure slowly increases. Okay, this if I have set in the scalar, what we have done is we have put something called as a T pause. It is either called T pause or an inspiratory pause, which you can preset, which you can define in a ventilator. Okay, in most of the ventilator you can define. So what it means is, once you reach the maximum of inspiration, just pause. You are not going to give any more oxygen or air inside, but do not open the exhalation valve. Wait for suppose 0.1 second till you open the exhalation valve. That means you are setting the ventilator in such a way that for this amount of time you push in air, and once this peak pressure is reached, or either Ti or peak pressure is reached, you give a pause of 0.1 second before the exhalation valve opens. So that is called as T pause. So as you can see, once you reach over here, a pause is given. See, the pause is given so that exhalation doesn't happen. It just time goes, and then at a defined time, that is, if you have set it as 0.1, at a defined time, the exhalation valve opens, and as passive exhalation happens, pressure drops. Okay, so now this is what this graph is. So imagine what happens during the initial phase of inspiration. During the initial phase of inspiration, pressure is due to, one is resistance, that is airway resistance. Imagine blowing through a small straw or a huge pipe. Okay, obviously huge pipe is easier. That means there is no bronchospasm, or there is nothing constricting the bronchus. You can the airway resistance will be very low, and easily you can push in more air. Okay, so that if there is no flow, if there is, you have to understand this very clearly, if there is no flow, then there is no resistance. Okay, if there is no flow, there is no resistance. So resistance is only generated when there is flow of air. Without flowing of air, you cannot measure the resistance. So what this graph has, graph explains is, so during the flow period, that is till here, you have inspiratory flow till here. During the flow period, you have two components of pressure. That is, one is resistance and one is the alveolar pressure. When you say alveolar pressure, it is basically dependent on the compliance. So basically two components, it is compliance and resistance. Okay, so peak inspiratory pressure is a measure of compliance and resistance. I'll just give an example once more. Imagine blowing a balloon through a small hole or through a small straw. Or on the other hand, imagine blowing a balloon with a thick balloon with a small straw. Okay, obviously the thick balloon and small straw will be the most difficult to inflate. Okay, the small straw is represents the resistance and the thick balloon represents the compliance of the alveoli. Now remove the small straw, keep a bigger straw, it will be a bit more easier. Now remove the thick balloon, keep the bigger straw and a thin balloon, that will be the easiest to inflate. Okay, so this is what peak inspiratory pressure represents. Basically peak inspiratory pressure represents the trans airway pressure, that is the resistance, and the alveolar pressure. Okay, now once the peak inspiratory pressure is reached, or once inspiration is stopped, okay, here we stop inspiration, what happens is the resistant part completely goes off. Okay, because there is no flow. So the pressure represented at that time, that is after stopping inspiration. So the flow is only there till this point. When there is no flow, the pressure immediately drops to the level of plateau pressure. So this plateau pressure represents alveolar pressure. Okay, because there is no flow here till your exhalation starts, there is no positive or negative flow. There is no flow in any direction. So there is no change in pressure happening. This only represents the pressure of the alveoli, that is the compliance. So basically, P-PLAT is a clear measure of your compliance. And peak inspiratory pressure is a measure of both your resistance and compliance. Okay, so common mistake is some say that peak inspiratory pressure is only due to resistance and P-PLAT is due to alveolar pressure. It is not like that. Peak inspiratory pressure is due to both alveolar pressure, that is plateau pressure, and your resistance. Okay, so I hope this term is clear. Peak inspiratory pressure, plateau pressure, and what represents the airway pressure. So this is what is represented as the airway pressure. Okay. Now, okay, this I'll show you. Now, so this is something which I've explained just now. So this is the distending alveolar pressure. That means this represents the thick balloon, and this area represents the airway resistance, depending on whether you use a small straw or a bigger straw. So the resistance is depicted by this area, and the alveolar pressure is depicted by this area. If you apply a T-pause, if T-pause is not applied, that is when you are asked to look at inspiratory pause, because in ARDS you have to check plateau pressure. I think everybody will know the importance of plateau pressure. Plateau pressure is you have to limit it below 30 in ARDS patients. So for that, you have to either apply a T-pause and keep so that you can check your plateau pressure regularly, or at a defined frequency, you have to apply something called as an inspiratory pause and check the plateau pressure and document it, and make sure that it doesn't go above 30. Okay. So that is why it is called as inflation hold in seconds or something. Okay, so these are the basics about scalars. Now I'll come to different types of modes of ventilation. Now coming to just look at this, I think most of you will understand. This is so first is flow, second is pressure, third is volume scalar, everything plotted on x-axis, time in the x-axis. Now, flow, as we have mentioned, it is a square wave pattern. Immediately, the flow reaches whatever X amount. And then during expiration, it goes down. That is negative pressure, negative flow starts, and slowly it decreases. Okay. Now this is what happens. Now volume. Now look at volume. So volume goes up and then comes down. This is pretty simple in time axis. Volume goes, reaches the peak and comes down. So I think you can tell me what type of scalar this is. Now look at the pressure. It just goes on increasing and then decreases, goes on increasing and then decreases. So what could this be? This is obviously an controlled mechanical ventilation, which is volume controlled. Now why I say this is volume controlled? Now, because flow is limited and you can see the pressure is varied depending on the volume. It is not a fixed pressure. If it is a fixed pressure, you will see in a pressure controlled or pressure targeted ventilation, you will see that the pressure level remains the same. It does not change. Only the volume will change according to the compliance. Okay. So pressure and volume and flow is always related. Just understand this mechanics that if the compliance is same, okay, if the compliance remains the same, you increase the pressure, volume will increase. In a pressure targeted ventilation, pressure is same, volume is dependent on compliance. In a volume targeted ventilation, volume remains the same, the peak pressure depends on the compliance. So if the compliance is low, peak pressure will increase in a volume controlled ventilation. On the other hand, in a pressure targeted ventilation, if the compliance is low, the volume will decrease because you have set a pressure. And based on that pressure, the inflation volume will be decided. So if the compliance is low, the pressure might not be enough for to reach a specific amount of volume. Okay. So all these are related. That's something what you have to understand. Now, what is the difference? What is the small change what you can see from the previous scalar? There is a small loop like, which goes negative initially in the pressure scalar. Now, this is an inspiratory effort, okay? Again, most of you will be knowing it. This is an inspiratory effort. Like what we have mentioned, seen before, the inspiratory effort is always negative because this inspiratory effort, this inspiratory effort is by the patient. So whatever the patient takes initially for inspiration is negative. So during this inspiratory effort, there is something called as trigger. I think you all would be knowing this. So during this inspiration, when there is a negative pressure, the ventilator senses that the patient is trying to take inspiration. That is called as trigger. And when this trigger is sensed, the ventilator gives a positive pressure. And again, when this comes down, when the next breath is initiated and when the trigger is set, when the trigger sensitivity is adequate and if it is set properly, during this effort, the inspiration starts again. So this is called as assist control. Now, most of our ventilators will have assist control modes because only control modes are rarely used now. Most of the time we use assist control. You put it in control mode and you let the patient also control the ventilation. Okay. What is this? Now in volume control ventilation, like what I've mentioned before, the compliance and resistance decides on the pressure. That is, in a volume control ventilation, you set a tidal volume, that is 400 ml, you set the flow, but the pressure, peak pressure is not decided by us or it is not defined. That is the variable here. So you can see this graph, that is the pressure is high and with the same settings, the pressure decreases. So what this means is the compliance or the resistance of the lung or the airway system was low here. That is why the pressures were high. And when the compliance improved, even those same settings with the same settings, the pressures became low. So basically it is the difference between a thick balloon, you need higher pressure to inflate the same amount of air imagine you need if you're inflating at the same amount of speed and same amount of volume, you need higher pressure to inflate same amount if it is a thicker balloon. So that is what is happening here. Okay. Now, what is this? I think this is again pretty straightforward. Now you can see that what are the changes here? You can see decelerating flow is seen here, and you can see the flow keeps on changing. Okay, this is flow was high here, flow is low here, and what you can see in the pressure scalar is there is a set pressure. That is, the pressure doesn't change in all breaths. Even when there is a change in flow, the pressure doesn't change. And you can see in the volume time scalar, the volume has decreased. Okay. Now, what happens in this is, again, the straight same thing what is previously explained. That is, when the compliance decreased, because this is a pressure targeted ventilation or pressure control ventilation, the pressure remains the same. So whatever happens to the lung, the pressure will remain the same. But if it is a low compliant system, that is when the compliance is low, in the same pressure, what the tidal volume will decrease and the flow will decrease. So this is the relation between pressure, volume and flow. This is something what you have to understand, whichever mode you're keeping, because it doesn't, most of the time, it doesn't matter which mode you're putting him in ventilation, but it matters how you troubleshoot them and how you understand the graphics and scalars. So in a pressure targeted ventilation, the pressure remains the same, the volume decreases. So imagine a patient, you have put on 12 pressure support or pressure control, and he was taking 400 tidal volume. After 6 hours, I'm seeing he's taking only 200 with the same set pressure, same 12 pressure control. So that is the time when you should understand that something is going wrong. And most of the time in scalars, what you do is it's like ECG. You should in your own ICU, you should set the scalars properly. That is, the dimensions should be set. It should not be changed for each patient, so that from a distance itself, you will know whether the tidal volume is low or not, seeing the scalars, or whether the flow is low, whether the respiratory rate is high. If you change the dimensions of X and Y axis, if you keep on changing it, you will not get a visual impression from a distance itself. If you keep it same for all patients, you will be able to do that. Now, next slide. So what is this? What do you understand from this? You can see that the flow is a little irregular. Okay. Imagine that flow is a little irregular and it doesn't reach the baseline. Okay. And it just gets cut off, and there is an inspiratory effort is there, and the pressure is set. So this is a pressure supported ventilation. Why I'm saying this is, one, there is an effort, and again, there is a variation in flow, and the flow doesn't reach baseline. In control, pressure control ventilation, the flow will reach the baseline because TI is set, it will reach the baseline. Cycling in pressure support is by you set in such a way that you cycle means when you change from inspiration to expiration, you define it by saying that when the flow reaches 25% of the maximum flow, that is peak inspiratory flow, that is the time you cycle. Okay, this is what you have told the ventilator. So because inspiratory flow is defined by the patient in a pressure support ventilation, so you set the pressure, patient can take air in more faster, okay, if he wants to, so the flow will increase. So imagine that, imagine taking inspiration. Once you start taking in, slowly your flow will decrease because your lung starts inflating. So once the flow starts decreasing, there should be a point when you should cycle. So that cycling point is defined by 25% or whatever value you keep. Most of the time it is set at 25 or 30, and you need not change it Okay. So if it is, if you set as 25%, what you have told the ventilator is that when it comes down to, when the inspiratory flow rate comes down to 25, that is the time when you cycle and exhalation valve opens. Okay. So that is why suddenly it goes to expiration from here. This is the expiration point. Okay. So then the tidal volume decreases. So what you have to understand from this is the pressure support is stable. It is pressure limited. And volume will vary according to the compliance of the lung. Now, what is this? I think this is a flow. You can see it looks like a controlled breath, volume controlled breath, because flow is limited. The pressure is peaking here. It is not pressure limited. And this looks like a sine pattern of flow, which is seen in, again, normal breath. So this means this is an intermittent ventilation. You have only intermittent ventilation. In between, the patient is allowed to take breath. You can see that negative pressure is there. You can see volume also is coming up, but it does not obviously reach up to a mechanical breath, because here it is supported, or it is a controlled breath. Okay, so this is an intermittent ventilation. Now what happens in SIMV? In SIMV with pressure support, okay, SIMV with pressure support, this is a controlled volume control ventilation here. Flow is limited. You have the pressure graph here. You can see that it is started by the patient itself, and volume also is increasing. Now, but the flow pattern suddenly changes here, and you can see the pressure pattern also, pressure scalar also changes. It becomes pressure limited. So this is a pressure supported ventilation. This flow doesn't reach the baseline. That is, it has been cut off by around 25%. It is cut off. So this is a pressure supported ventilation, and this is a volume controlled ventilation. So this is again an SIMV plus pressure support. Okay, now you have SIMV volume control plus pressure support, you have SIMV pressure control plus pressure support. So you can put in either of those. Okay, now what is this? Now what happens in CPAP? Now CPAP graphics is probably least used, but still you should know what happens. As you can see, the flow is sine pattern because it is spontaneous breath. Now there is always an positive pressure here. Okay. So from there, it is like you take in negative, then as the inspiration goes, it reaches positive, and then expiration is over, next inspiration. So this is what happens. So what you have to understand is it doesn't go negative. That is, alveolar pressure doesn't go below zero. Usually in normal breaths, it goes below zero. Here you keep a PEEP around 5 or something. That is, CPAP around 5 means pressure will be always above 5. So on that 5, you start breathing your normal breath. So that is what happens in CPAP. That is why it is called as continuous positive pressure airways. Okay. Now, pressure volume loop, I'll come to the loops. Now, these loops are important, and you should know. Most of the time we use scalars. I think scalars are the most important things, but you have to use loops in some patients also. So coming to pressure volume loop, now when you say pressure volume loops as standard, pressure is plotted in the x-axis and volume is plotted in the y-axis. So as I've mentioned before, so just imagine this is pressure and volume. As inspiration starts, pressure and volume both increases, okay? And there will be a time when the volume suddenly starts increasing, okay? This is the volume suddenly starts increasing, and it reaches a maximum point. Now here, after this, even if you increase the pressure, it is because the volume might not increase. So that is called as peaking. It will go to this side because only the pressure will increase, volume will not increase. That is called as over distension. That means volume is not getting increased, only pressure is getting increased. Now, from here, expiration starts. So what happens when expiration starts? Expiration starts, the pressure will drop immediately. That is, the pressure is going back, and volume will start dropping once you reach this upper inflection point. Okay. I'll talk about inflection point next. So as expiration continues, there will be a decrease in volume and decrease in pressure. So this loop is quite easy. As you can see, pressure and volume will increase. Reach at the end of inspiration, it starts decreasing. Okay. Coming to, okay, now if you set a peep, what happens if you set a peep? If you set a peep, what it means is it does not go back to zero. The pressure does not go back to zero. So as you can see, the pressure volume loop will be shifted towards the right. So this is the peep. You can see that peep mentioned here. It starts from here and ends here. So this peep, whatever, if you have kept it at 5, it does, the pressure never goes below 5. As you have seen in the scalar, it will not go below 5. Now inflection points. Now there are two inflection points. There have been lot of thoughts and studies and debates on this, whether you have to set peep according to upper or lower inflection points. But anyway, nothing has come out significantly important on this. All you have to understand this, what you have to understand is, if you keep a peep or after the lower inflection point, the change in volume per unit change in pressure is definitely very high. You can see that the volume suddenly goes up. So change in volume per unit pressure is definitely high after your lower inflection point. Now that same thing, so this part, if you draw a line here, this part is your lower and upper inflection point pressures. Okay, it's actually, you look at it as that there's a lot of difference, but if you look at the pressure points, it's not much of a, there is not much difference between the both. See, you can see this, the pressure may be coming around here. Okay, so pressure point may be here, the upper inflection point, and the lower inflection point is here in the pressure. So it doesn't make much of a difference in your peep, but this is something what you have to understand. There are two points like this, but because we might be putting these terms again. Okay, now work of breathing, how does this help in asserting work of breathing? So definitely this part is your inspiration. Okay, inspiration, again, like what we have mentioned before, depends on the resistive work and your compliance of the lung. Because what is compliance? Basically, it is unit change in volume for each change in pressure. Okay. So how much volume is inflated for each change in pressure? That is your compliance. So that means if the compliance is low, that is, if the compliance is poor, you need higher pressures to reach a little higher, a little bit of volume. Okay, so this whole graph will have a lower slope. Okay, I'll explain it to you. So basically, basically inspiration is your resistive work and compliance, and expiration, as mentioned before, is the elastic work. It is passive. Okay, flow volume loop. This is the next loop. We will be talking about only two loops here. So flow volume loop, you have inspiration here and then expiration in the lower side. The negative side is your expiration. Basically, it is the direction of flow. Again, this is a loop because it is not plotted against time. The flow also starts at zero and ends at zero. So when there is an flow, you can see this is flow. The volume is plotted in x-axis and flow is plotted in y-axis. So as you can see, the flow increases during inspiration, and peak inspiratory flow, something which we had seen in scalar, is seen here. The peak inspiratory flow continues till expiration is started. So here peak inspiratory flow is there. Once expiration starts, immediately it shifts to negative. That is, the direction of flow changes. Direction of flow changes, and peak expiratory flow decreases. The peak expiratory flow decreases slowly. It does not increase or decrease like in inspiration, because it is due to elastic recoil. It slowly decreases and reaches the functional residual capacity. Okay, so this is about flow volume loop. Now, I think this is basically, there are some things which abnormalities which you can identify or diagnose on graphics. I'll be talking about each one of this. Now, coming to air leak, it is very easy. In a volume scalar, you can see that there is no, the volume doesn't reach zero. That is, whatever goes in doesn't come out. So it is either air leak or you have something called as auto beep. Okay, So leak means leak in the system. So it can be leak in the ET tube or leak anywhere. Maybe the cuff pressure is loose or so. But if you see this graph, you should understand that there is an air leak. Okay. Now, what happens in flow in an air leak? You can see that during an air leak, during expiration, the flow decreases, and it is supposed to be zero, but it becomes positive because the air leak is there. And this part is in liter per minute, actually, is the amount of air leak. Okay. Now, air leak, you actually need not to look at the scalar just to diagnose air leak. There will be other indicators, most of the time, a low peak pressure, a tidal volume, which there is a difference, there will be a difference between expiratory and inspiratory tidal volume, and the graphics will help you in finding out air leak. Now, this also, if you look at the loop, this also will easily help you to find out air leak. Look at this inspiration, volume reaches there, and from there, during the expiration, the volume does not reach to zero. Volume is plotted in x-axis, volume reaches to some amount. So this much amount of volume is the air leak in ml. Okay. Now, in what happens in pressure volume PV loop? In PV loop, you can see the volume is plotted in y-axis, so the volume doesn't reach zero. So you can it will be somewhere here, and this is the amount of air leak again in ml. This is something again important which you have to understand: obstruction versus active expiration, or obstruction versus low compliance, I would put it as. Now look at this. During an obstruction means during a bronchospasm, what will happen to your flow pattern? During a bronchospasm, there will be no change in inspiration, because inspiration flow, this is set in volume control. We have set this, the ventilator, we have defined this in the ventilator. That is why there is no change. Now look at this during expiration, this is passive. Because this is passive, this explains the ventilation mechanics of the airway system. Okay, the inspiration part is set by the ventilator. We have set it in the ventilator, so this does not give us any information of what is happening, but this will give us an information of what is happening in the airway system. So now imagine again, I would say that if there is a bronchospasm, the flow, it will definitely take more time. Imagine blowing out through a smaller pipe or a smaller straw. It will take more time. The expiratory time will be more, and the peak expiratory flow rate also will be slower, because higher the diameter, the faster the flow rate. Okay, higher the diameter, the faster the flow rate. So if the flow rate is not high, that means if the flow rate is coming down, that means there is some amount of bronchospasm happening here. So just look at this graph. You can see the flow rate has decreased, and because the flow rate has decreased, we have set a tidal volume, that is 400 ml. Suppose if we have set 400 ml, and if the flow rate has decreased from 100 to 50, it will take almost double the time to reach zero. Okay, so you can see that in bronchospasm or any obstructive pattern, the peak expiratory flow rate will be slow, obviously, because the diameter has decreased, and it will take more time to reach zero because the flow rate has decreased. So in bronchospasm, you will get a delayed there will be an extended expiratory time, and the flow to reach the zero level will be delayed. So that is how it is going to be in a bronchospasm. Now imagine, on the other hand, if the compliance is low. Imagine what happens if the compliance is low. Just imagine a thick balloon. You have you suddenly start deflating it. Just you let it out. Compared to a thin balloon, the flow will be higher in the thicker balloon, because the pressure mounted there in the same amount of volume, for the same amount of volume, is high. So starting in a low compliant system, starting of this will be the peak expiratory flow rate will be high. And what happens is, because the flow rate is high, it will finish also soon. That this expiratory time taken to taken for the amount of volume to get over, that is to for expiration to take place, will also be low. That is TE also will be low. So what compared to the normal, in a low compliant system, the peak, there will be a peak in the flow, and this will reach zero very fast. So it will be pointed and narrow here. It will be that is in a low compliance system. It will not be pointed, and it will be actually wider in in an obstructed system. That is where there is a bronchospasm or something like that. Okay. So this is again easily and commonly used to identify problems during your mechanical ventilation. And our response to bronchodilators, this is something which I have just explained. So there will be expiratory flow rate will be low when there is bronchospasm, and a long TE will be there. Once you give bronchodilators, what happens is the expiratory flow rate will increase and the TE will decrease. Okay, so you can see this is easily seen in this. So that is how it changes. Okay. During a bronchodilation, and you can also assess your bronchodilation effectiveness by looking at your peak expiratory flow rate and also your peak pressures. Increased airway resistance, what happens to your loops? I'm just telling you, I'm showing you all what happens in the loops. As you can see, this is the expiration part. Again, I'm telling you, expiration is important to assess airway resistance, because inspiration is positive pressure. It is air is being pushed in. You will not be able to understand what is happening inside the lung. To know the physiology, expiratory part of loops or scalars will help you. Okay. So as you can see, what we have mentioned before, the flow will be low. That is why this becomes cooped out. Okay. Once the expiration starts here, there will be a decrease in peak expiratory flow rate, and the flow rate also will be low. It is not put on time, so obviously it will reach zero. It will reach zero, and then see. This is looking at this. Okay, so this is not plotted on time, so that is why we will not be able to know whether how much time it has taken. It will obviously reach zero before the start of next inspiration. So as you can see, this is what is happening in your flow volume loops. Okay, now increased resistance, I think I'll put this in the next slide. Okay, coming to air trapping. Now, this is very important. Air trapping is something, again, which is most commonly used, most commonly found out thing by looking at your flow time scalar. Okay. Now, what happens in air trapping is, just a second. What happens in air trapping is, you can see that in flow, that is during the expiratory flow. Before that, what is air trapping? Air trapping means, as the name suggests, the amount of volume, how much it goes in, doesn't come out. There is some amount of air or some amount of volume of air which is trapped inside the lung. Okay, so this happens when you have an increased respiratory rate, or when there is no adequate time, or when there is inadequate time for expiration. Okay, so inadequate time for expiration is the main thing. So just look at this flow. During this flow, this is suppose a volume controlled ventilation. You have a flow limited inspiration, so 500 ml of tidal volume has got in, and you need around maybe 3-4 seconds 3 seconds to get out this 500 ml of tidal volume, or 4 seconds, let's put it as 4 seconds. What happens is, due to bronchospasm, like what we have mentioned before, due to this obstructive pattern, or due to some reason, there is an increased expiratory time. Okay, that is the flow, peak expiratory flow decreased, and due to this, what we have explained before, the expiratory time has increased. Now, why this expiratory time has increased is due to bronchospasm or whatever the reason may be. Now, what has happened here is usually after this flow reaches zero, then only inspiration starts. So its flow will reach zero. So if you have kept respiratory rate at 12, there will be lot of time, and after that there will be a pause, and then only inspiration will be started by the ventilator. Now what happens in during this auto PEEP is, or air trapping, is there will not be adequate time for expiration, so it does not reach zero. Actually, it was supposed to reach zero maybe somewhere over here, okay, in this part. We are not having that much time. The patient starts breathing, or we have set a higher respiratory rate, the next inspiration starts here, even before completion of complete expiratory flow. So some amount of tidal volume is set. So if this does not reach the baseline, you have to understand that the patient is not able to completely exhale whatever tidal volume he has inhaled. Okay, this is what it suggests. So if you see this, you should always think of auto PEEP or air trapping. Okay. Just a minute. Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, just give me a second, I think.
Only thing, video is not available.
Okay, 1 minute.
Yeah, now we can see you.
Yes, okay.
Yes, very good.
Okay, fine. I was talking about air trapping. Now, as similar thing will happen in the flow volume loop. So in auto PEEP, as you can see, the expiration the flow will not reach zero. See, you can see the expiratory flow does not reach zero. That is what happens in auto PEEP or air trapping. Okay. Now, something air trapping is something what you have to understand, and this is actually quite important, and it's easily found out using scalars. And this is if you do not find out air trapping or auto PEEP, this can lead to dynamic hyperinflation, cardiac arrest, and this is, believe me, quite common. If you do not find out, especially when the patient wakes up from sedation or during ARDS ventilation, okay. Okay. Now, how do you find out auto PEEP, and what is auto PEEP? Should I, Rene sir, if you are there, should I explain on this auto PEEP, or was it explained previously? I did not attend the previous classes.
No, I think you can explain.
Okay, fine. So basically, what you have to understand from auto PEEP is that PEEP is something, I'll just tell you what is happening with the ventilator and basic mechanics. So PEEP is something what you have set in the mechanical ventilation, and that means the breath, if you have set PEEP of 5, breath will start or inspiratory pressures will start only from 5. Okay, the ventilator thinks that the highest pressure in the lowest pressure in the body is 5, and breath will be started from there, and triggering also will be started from there. So triggering is done by, you have two types of trigger: flow trigger and pressure trigger. That is trigger, just to mention this, the trigger means the patient gives some information to the ventilator so that the ventilator knows that you have to start inspiration. Okay, so when an awake patient, when he takes a flow, that is when he takes a flow or when he takes a negative pressure of air inside, okay, at that is the time, if you have, suppose you have set it as negative pressure 2, the trigger is set as minus 2, minus 3 of pressure, or depending on your flow. So suppose, for example, you have set it as minus 2. So if you take negative pressure of minus 2, that is minus 2 pressure, that is the time when ventilator understands that, okay, the patient is trying to inspire, so let us start an assist controlled breath. Okay, so this is what happens in an assist controlled breath. So when you have set a PEEP of 5, when you take a negative pressure of minus 2 from 5, that is from this 5, there will be a negative deflection of minus 2. That is what you have seen in the previous scalars. When there is a negative deflection of minus 2, that is when the pressure reaches 3. From 5 minus 2 is 3. So when the pressure reaches 3, the ventilator will start its inspiratory process. Okay. Now, first you have to understand the normal process. So this is normally what happens. So when you set a trigger of minus 2 and a PEEP of 5, what happens is when the pressure reaches 3 from 5, because the baseline is 5 according to the ventilator, baseline is 5. From 5, when you take a negative pressure of 2, that when it reaches 3, that is the time when inspiration starts. So any time in the airway system a pressure of 3 is there, the ventilator will start an inspiration. Okay, this is the this is what happens normally. Okay, now imagine during auto PEEP. Now, what is auto PEEP? Auto PEEP, as the name suggests, is PEEP which is automatically generated, which we do not set. Okay, so that is something due to air trapping, which we have just now explained. That is, during air trapping, what happens is few ml or some ml of air is trapped in each breath. So when air is trapped, suppose for example 50 ml of air is trapped in each breath, it is distributed among different alveoli. So each breath, this pressure inside the alveoli will increase. That is, the PEEP inside the alveoli will increase. Okay, when the PEEP inside the alveoli increases in each breath, that is the time when we call it as auto PEEP. Though we have kept it at 5, because some of the air remains inside after expiration, that is the time when the pressure increases there, and we call it as auto PEEP. Am I clear with the understanding of auto PEEP, what auto PEEP is? So even though we have set it as 5, the pressure inside the alveoli might be 10 or 15. Even though we have set the PEEP as 5, the pressure inside the alveoli might be 10 because of the air is trapped. Okay, is this concept clear?
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Okay, so that is auto PEEP. Now, what happens in what happens is, during auto PEEP, suppose let us assume that there is a generated auto PEEP of 10, okay, and the PEEP kept is 5, what we have defined in the ventilator is 5. So according to the ventilator, the pressure required, pressure in the airway system, baseline airway system is 5. The ventilator does not require auto PEEP by itself, okay. So according to the ventilator, the pressure inside the airway system, a lowest pressure is 5. So the pressure required to trigger, suppose you have set the trigger as -2, same like the previous scenario, the pressure required to reach the trigger is 3. That is from 5 minus 2 is 3. So taking the previous scenario, the ventilator will start an inspiration whenever the pressure is 3 inside the airway system. Okay, I hope this is also clear. That is triggering. Now what happens is the airway system inside, due to autopeep, the pressure actually is 10 because of autopeep. Okay, so from 10, the patient will have to take an effort of 7 minus 7 to reach 3. Otherwise, the ventilator will not start an inspiration. Okay, so I'll just explain it again. Usually from 5 to 3, that is 5 minus 2, only you have to take a negative pressure of minus 2 to reach a pressure of 3, and an inspiratory and assist control breath is started. But when there is an autopeep of 10, what happens is the ventilator doesn't know that there is an autopeep. Ventilator will start an inspiration only if the pressure reaches 3. So from 10, the patient has to take an inspiratory effort of minus 7 to reach 3. That is the time when an inspiratory when an assist ventilator breath is given. Now this is why, if you see an autopeep patient, you will see that the patient takes 1, 2, 3, 4 breaths, and maybe fifth breath there will be a controlled breath. Okay, you will see that patient ventilation dyssynchrony is commonly seen in autopeep. That you will see that the patient tries to take breath, but the ventilator will not initiate the inspiratory assisted inspiration. This is because of the phenomenon which I have just mentioned. That is, even though we have put the trigger as minus 2 only, the patient will have to take minus 7 or higher to reach that trigger point because an autopeep is generated inside the alveoli. Am I clear with this? There might be doubts, but
I think the point is very clear.
Okay, fine. So that is what happens in autopeep. So you can just look at this graph. Normal peep is this. So this is the baseline according to the ventilator, and when there is a trigger here till here, it starts the inspiratory breath. But as the autopeep reaches 9, you have to trigger from there till 3 or whatever set trigger to start an inspiratory breath. So that is the problem with autopeep. And how do you find out autopeep is put an expiratory hold. During an expiratory hold, as mentioned before, there will be no resistance pattern. So there will be the resistance part is avoided. So whatever pressure is there during expiration will be reflected in the ventilator, and you can easily see the total peep in the ventilator. Okay, the total peep in the ventilator will be reflected. So if that is above the peep which you have set, that means that is a total peep. Usually an difference of 5 and all is okay. That is usually seen. Okay, so more than 5 of difference between total peep and peep, that means the autopeep is getting generated there. Okay, so that is about autopeep. Now coming to dyssynchrony, there are a lot of dyssynchronies which you can find out. One is autopeep, obviously. Now inadequate inspiratory flow, what happens is during a positive flow rate, the patient tries to inspire more. That is, the volume is not adequate. Okay, when the volume is not adequate, what happens is patient, you are giving 300 ml of tidal volume, there is metabolic acidosis, patient wants 500-600 ml. So in 300 ml you will see that the patient will be inspiring again and again, and you will see that the flow or pressure pattern will be actually rugged due to negative deflections. Okay, This again, it will same with the loop also. So this is the flow pattern here. So flow, sorry, pressure volume loop. And in this pressure is there is a negative pressure because again pressure during inspiration, normal inspiration, or whenever we take when the patient breathes, it's negative. The positive pressure is given by the ventilator. So in a pressure time scalar or in a pressure volume loop, if you see a deflection like this, this suggests that the flow is inadequate. Okay, this is also commonly seen and most of the time easily found out using scalars or loops. Inadequate sensitivity is something what it's basically dependent on the trigger. If the trigger sensitivity is not adequate, that is, if you have kept a trigger of minus 10, that means a patient is trying to breathe. See, you can see this is a spontaneous breath. Patient is trying to breathe, but the, we are not giving mechanical ventilator breath. Assisted breath is not given. And this results in increased work of breathing, something what happens with auto PEEP also. So next is over distension. Over distension is easy. As you, what we have mentioned is as the pressure increases, the volume doesn't increase. So you can see that it goes for peaking. The pressure goes on rising, but the volume will not increase. So there is no point in increasing from here. It will only cause barotrauma and barotrauma more after this, volutrauma and barotrauma after this. So there will be no or only minimal change in volume with increase in pressure. So this is called as over distension. When you reach a point of this, you're not supposed to increase PEEP after this. Okay. PIP versus PLAT, I think I mentioned it. What you have to understand, I'll just mention it again. This is peak inspiratory pressure. This is plateau pressure. So during and high resistance, during and high resistance, what will happen? This part will increase and the PPLAT will remain more or less same. When there is bronchospasm or any cause of high resistance, the plateau pressure will more or less remain same and the peak inspiratory pressure will be high. On the other hand, if there is a low compliance, the plateau pressure and peak inspiratory pressure both will be high, but the difference will not be peak inspiratory pressure minus PPLAT pressure will not change, or only there will be minimal change. Now, during high flow, what happens is this, there will be an increase in the peak inspiratory pressure because the flow is fast and the time is low, time is short. Because the flow is high, definitely TI will be low. So when the flow is faster, same amount of tidal volume, faster flow, the pressures will increase. So these are the four basic concepts which you have to get. I think it should be pretty clear. That is, PPLAT will increase only if there is an increase in compliance. PIP will increase if there is an increase in compliance or an increase in resistance. If PPLAT is normal and PIP goes on increasing, that means there is a problem with resistance. So basic idea is this. I have demonstrated, there are graphics showing this, and I think it is clear. This is an increased airway resistance. You can see that this part goes on increasing. The PPLAT will not increase, only the peak inspiratory pressure will increase. Okay. Now this is with an plateau pressure going on increasing when this is a flow because there is a decreased inspiratory time. You can see this inspiratory time decreases, the pressure goes up because the time of inspiration is decreased. Okay, now this is increase in plateau pressure. Okay, so when there is an increase in plateau pressure, the peak inspiratory pressure also will increase, the plateau pressure also will increase, but the difference does not change. That is, the resistance part does not change. Plateau pressure and peak inspiratory pressure increases. Okay. Now, what happens? The changes in PV loop during compliance changes. Now, when this is in pressure targeted ventilation.
May I intervene?
Yes.
We have another topic, patient monitoring and abnormal ventilator waveforms by Dr. Binu later. So I think most of the abnormal pattern, we have separate session also.
Okay, fine.
For the information. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. I think mine is almost over. Just okay. Basic on compliance changes. If the in a pressure targeted ventilation, with a unit change in pressure, the tidal volume changed will be low when the compliance is low. So when there is a change, you need lot of change in pressure to reach even a change in small change in tidal volume. So what happens is whenever there is low compliance, this pressure volume loop tends to the slope of the pressure volume loop will be lower. Okay, you can see that the lower the compliance, it goes down. So this happens with both. Even in the volume targeted ventilation also this happens. This is with high compliance. This is a good compliance. When the compliance is low, it just shifts to the right side. Now airway secretions, as you can see, it is again it's common and it's easily found out using a flow volume loop or in your flow time scalar. You will see that it will be rugged because the flow will be disrupted due to secretions. Basically, all these graphics are required to understand physiology better and the modes also. And for troubleshooting, it is absolutely necessary. I think being an intensivist or any physician taking care of ICU, a good knowledge of scalars and loops is absolutely necessary.
Thank you, Dr. That was an excellent talk, very simple to understand even for a beginner. Really, I appreciate you and thank you on the behalf of our department, pulmonary medicine from Amala Institute of Medical Science. Now the topic is open for discussion. Any queries, I think you can ask directly to the speaker or you can type a message so that I will read it for you. I think the organizer can unmute all the participants so that they can ask any queries to the speaker. And I request the senior faculties to add any points. Professor Davis Paul, sir. I think the topic was very clear. You are regarding the auto PEEP and the scalars and all well presented. I think the flow volume loop is just the inverted flow volume loop which we are routinely seeing in our battery. So I think we are usually inverting the images so that we will more familiar with the ventilator graphics there. If we are suspecting any pneumothorax, how it will appear in the ventilator waveforms?
The peak inspiratory pressure will increase. That is, it is just like any pressure increase problem, any obstructive problem. You will see that the peak and plateau pressure both will increase. That is, you will see it as a basically it's a plateau pressure increase problem. So this will be the problem. You will see it will come like this.
For the sake of our residents, could you explain driving pressure?
Just to complete that pneumothorax, in pneumothorax, you will have an obstruction so that the plateau pressure, distending pressure of the alveoli will increase. And what you will find out is a peak inspiratory pressure going up. Okay. So, and when you look, you'll see that the plateau pressure will be high and the resistance part will be okay because the pneumothorax will not have any problem in resistance. Okay. Now, sir, I didn't get your second question, sir.
Can you tell me about the driving pressure for the sake of our residents?
Driving pressure is the pressure required or pressure which we either set or which comes in for inflating the lung. So what all this, whatever you have set, this is a volume controlled setting. So in volume control setting, the driving pressure depends on the volume. So the driving pressure slowly goes up and reaches your highest pressure here. Here the driving pressure is your peak inspiratory pressure and then it comes down. In pressure control ventilation, this will be a targeted, that is, it will be a limited pattern. So that is your driving pressure. In volume control, the driving pressure slowly increases, and in pressure targeted, it is a limited part. Now there is a lot of importance in driving pressure now in for ARDS ventilation, because previously it was thought that low tidal volume ventilation was the only thing that showed mortality benefit. But then studies and restructuring of previous studies, they have found that in low tidal volume, because pressure and volume is always related, in low tidal volume there is always low driving pressure, and irrespective of low tidal volume, low driving pressure was a sign of decreased mortality also. Okay, that is the importance of driving pressure. Because so what I'm trying to say is, even though you can, you have a tidal volume of 300, 350 with a pressure of 15, if you can decrease it to 12 pressure in a pressure targeted ventilation, you should decrease it to 12. That is, you should keep the lowest possible driving pressure to achieve your targeted tidal volume. So basic, that is the inference what you get from the recent studies.
Okay. Any queries? If no more queries, I think we will wind up the session. Thank you so much, Dr. Fasil, once again. Thanks from our department and all the faculties and all the delegates who are present here, and also sincere thanks to the sponsors, CIPLA. Thank you, Dr. Fasil.
Thank you. Thank you.
Edison is here still.
കഴിക്കണ്ട റെഡി കഷ്ണം കൂടി കേട്ട
എല്ലാവരും ടി വി ചെയ്യാം ഞാൻ വൈൻഡപ്പ് ചെയ്ത് പെട്ടെന്ന്